A very good morning and warm welcome to all the delegates who have joined us today on the virtual platform for day two of the Livelihood India Summit 2021. We apologize for the couple of minutes delay in starting the proceedings. We will be starting with the first technical session for the day. It's titled The Poorest of the Poor, Innovations from Practice. The session has been co-curated in partnership with Hand in Hand India. Building livelihoods and assets for the poorest of the poor, often referred to as POP, continues to be a major challenge for India. Not only do the poorest of the poor suffer from discrimination based on caste and gender, but often they are simply invisible to development administrators and they continue to remain alienated from the mainstream. Additionally, all of them feel intimidated by the system and the people who run these systems. Over the past few years, justifiably, these issues have started taking center stage, and there have been noteworthy efforts from both government and non-government organizations to address this challenge. Through this session, we hope to identify strategies and measures to support the poorest of the poor to transition out of the state of chronic poverty. With this, it is my great privilege to introduce the panel for this session. As a panelist, we have today Mr. Sushant Verma, Asia Regional Director, Trickle Up. We have Mr. Binju Abraham, Integrator Pradhan. We have Dr. Maninder Kaur Dwivedi, Principal Secretary, Department of Rural Industries, Government of Chhattisgarh. And we hope to have join us shortly, Mr. Balamurugan D, CEO, Bihar Rural Livelihoods Promotion Society, BRLPS. And I'm also privileged to welcome Dr. Madhusharan, President, Hand in Hand India, for moderating this session. Dr. Madhusharan is a livelihoods and gender specialist. She has over 15 years of experience in facilitating economic empowerment of rural women. As President, Hand in Hand India, she oversees projects related to social mobilization, SDG management, skilling, financial inclusion, facilitating access to credit for livelihoods promotion and integrated community development. Prior to her stint at Hand in Hand India, she was also working closely with bilateral and multilateral organizations, including ADB, GIZ, and DFID. With this, I hand over the stage to Professor Dr. Madhusharan. The floor is now yours, Dr. Madhusharan.
Thank you so much, Mayank, for this warm welcome. And I really, on behalf of Access Hand in Hand India and all the technical partners, I give a extend a warm welcome to all the panelists. I'm really honored to anchor this session with this wonderful line of panelists, each of whom has a very, very rich experience in multiple aspects of supporting livelihoods promotions and have taken a lot of innovative strategies to impact change at the community level with the poorest of the poor. To begin with, I would just like to say that we are not going to get too much into the definition of the poorest of the poor, just to say that we will be focusing on the initiatives and innovations for the bottom 30% of the population, because that is what Niti Aayog, UNDP, Oxford and Human Development Index have come up with, this multidimensional poverty index, which is a sum of parameters of education, health and standard of living. So instead of going through a poverty line approach, we will focus our discussions on the bottom 30% of the population and talk about the innovations and strategies for this section of the population to integrate them in the development process of society. To set the tone, I would like to talk a bit about my organization, Hand in Hand India. Hand in Hand India is a leading NGO working across 17 states of the country. And our model of job creation has been replicated in over 10 countries across the globe. We have, Hand in Hand works on scale because we realize that there is that much need to impact change and to promote jobs and livelihoods across the districts of India. So, till date, we are working with almost 26 lakh women, having formed about 23,000 SHGs and have created over 4.7 million jobs for the bottom of the pyramid. And that is the section that we work for, the bottom of the pyramid. It could be the last 30% or the bottom 40%, but that is our focus. It could be the urban poor, it could be the rural poor, it could be BPL or above poverty line, but yes, the last 40% of the section of the population. Hand in hand follows a very, very structured approach to work for job creation and enterprise development or livelihood promotion. We follow a very, almost like the NRLM pattern of job creation, of course, with a lot of changes along the way for maximum impact. We work we work on social mobilization, forming women into SHGs, giving a series of training on SHG management, financial literacy, skill development training, banking, accounting. Then we focus on the access to credit, the crucial missing part, very, very crucial, but yet the missing link in livelihood promotion, facilitating credit from banks, from microfinance institutions, from SHG's own internal pool of savings, because that also becomes a substantial size sometimes. We focus a lot on financial inclusion and access to government schemes because we find that last mile connectivity is extremely important because there are so many schemes of the government of India and that much of lack of awareness at the grassroots on the government schemes. So whether it is schemes for housing, Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, or for education, or for health, environment, toilet construction, we facilitate all the schemes down to the last mile. And finally, we work with federations, forming large scale women-led federations that in hand-in-hand parlance we call cluster-level networks and block-level networks. And our reach, like I said, hand-in-hand likes to work on scale. We have formed almost 823 federations, each federation comprising 100 women each. And these are strong groups that lead to advocacy, village development change, women empowerment, market linkages, for value chain development, negotiating with the middlemen for fair pricing and better marketing. So this is the approach of hand in hand. Coming to what has worked for hand in hand in terms of and taking the topic ahead, innovations for the poorest of the poor from practice, a lot of our interventions have just origin from need-based. Once it has been tested, then it has been scaled up. I would just like to talk about three things that hand in hand has done, which has really worked for us. One is livelihoods financing. We realized early on, while banks were very, very keen, because we work very closely with the banks, hand-in-hand works completely with the government. We are not so much an advocacy-driven, taking a stand against the government. We work with the government because they are the largest promoter of change and development in society. But banks also have their limitations in terms of their size of credit, in terms of the time of credit. So hand-in-hand, we have our own microfinance wing called microfinance company called Bellstar Investment, which is a subsidiary of Budbud. And according to MFIN, we are the most responsible microfinance institution. We do a lot of social financing, which means apart from credit, we also give a lot of credit plus skilling, enterprise development, marketing, digital technology. That is what the MFI promotes, which gives a very good client connect for livelihood promotion. The second thing, innovations from practice that we have done and which has yielded good results is focusing on business development training. How did we realize it? Because we realized that women in Tamil Nadu are really strong in terms of their entrepreneurial skills. So we scaled it up. Along with IIT Madras, we developed a one-year entrepreneurship business development program for the women entrepreneurs, where 3,000 women were given a one-year training on business management skills, technology, marketing, and then mentored for 6 months. The results of this business development training to the entrepreneurs has led to such wonderful results in the digital space that women are obviously transacting on online platform, selling their products, are women in Tamil Nadu on Amazon, Flipkart, Myntra, that this has become an integral part of our innovations. Till date, almost I would say that 4.7 lakh women at Hand in Hand have been given the business development training. And finally, what we have also promoted a lot is digital literacy, because we find that, again, a huge need of online business, platform marketing. Forget about going online, just the B2B connect, women interacting with each other through WhatsApp platform. COVID was a huge learning. And then we have seen the change. Despite job losses, our women were able to hold on and become the single sole breadwinners of their bread earners of their family because of this digital technology and marketing on a B2B platform. So these are some of the innovative changes. We will discuss more as we go along. So these are the innovations that have worked. Of course, projects have also been very, very beneficial. A good project, the end line results of which have led us to upscale. For example, I have told this a couple of times, the Asian Development Bank supported project of promoting energy-based enterprises across 33 districts of Madhya Pradesh. The results were phenomenal. And now we have started promoting energy-based enterprises across our 17 states, where you have rural women doing motorized pottery, CFL bulb production, paper, chemical bangle. Then you have a project supported by DFID for financial literacy. Again, the results of promoting 50,000 women on financial literacy and the end line results by a third-party evaluation has led us to incorporate it in our regular program. So projects like these, which have left a huge impact, Vodafone supported project of enabling 50,000 women to interact on a B2B platform. So these are the innovations from practice which have become now a regular feature of our work area, and of course has led to some promising results. So having said that, just setting the tone, I would now like to invite our first speaker for the session, Mr. Sushant Verma. Sushant is, of course, as we know, the Asia Regional Director of Chicklup. Chicklup has done amazing work in actually following a very structured graduation approach in impacting to tackle poverty, discrimination, and exclusion, and really helped to make profitable businesses. Chicklup works across 19 countries, three states of India, Jharkhand, West Bengal, and Odisha. And really, so from Sushant, if you could just talk a little bit about the graduation approach that Chicklup follows and some of the innovations that you have undertaken. We would also be interested to hear about the monitoring parameters that you follow to ensure that the impact is actually felt at the grassroots. So could you just throw light on some of these aspects, Sushant, over to you. You are on mute, Sushant.
Thank you, Madhuji, for this introduction, and good morning, everyone. First of all, my sincere gratitude to Access team for organizing Livelihood Summit despite of all odds and inviting me to share the Chicklup experience. Unfortunately, we cannot see audience, but thanks for joining this interesting session, as many people don't talk about poorest of the poor or ultra poor. Boom. Anyway, I represent an organization called Chicklup. Chicklup's mission is to support ultra-poor women escaping extreme poverty and vulnerability. Chicklup was started way back in 1979, and Chicklup has supported women who have struggled to survive on less than $1.90 a day, forging resilient and sustainable livelihood. In India, Chicklup basically partners with the local NGOs for implementation of the program, and also we do partnership with the State Rural Livelihood Mission, and we have partnered with JSLPS, Jharkhand State Livelihood Promotion Society, and Orissa's livelihood mission to promote the inclusion of ultra poor and particularly vulnerable tribes, which we call them ABTG, within the government of India livelihood scheme. Presently, we work in three states: West Bengal, Orissa, and Jharkhand. And in India, we have been very active for last 15-16 years. As Madhuji has asked to throw some light on graduation approach, I'll give a little introduction about graduation approach. What is this? How it is started? And then I'll share the trickle up experience. I think one of the most promising approach for promoting the social and economic mobility of the extremely poor has been the graduation approach. Originally, it was developed at targeting the ultra poor, and this program was started by BRAC in Bangladesh, and then it was globally experimented, and the result has been phenomenal. And Trickle Up has been working on graduation approach. There are few agencies globally who work on graduation approach. There are several other approaches, tested models, but Trickle Up choose to work on graduation approach. Graduation approach basically is a holistic livelihood program designed to address the multidimensional need of extremely poor households. It consists of six core components. It's a big thing to discuss, but I'm going in very short to just introduce what exactly graduation approach is and how we work. So it consists of six core components: time limited consumption support, a savings component, asset transfer and training in how to use the asset, and life skills training, coaching and mentoring. In Trickle Up, we don't go to a village and distribute goats to all family, or seeds to all family, or agriculture equipment to all family. We do individual livelihood planning for each household. I'll talk about it later. But the theory of change underlying the model is that mix of intervention offered in a appropriate sequence, as I mentioned that there are six steps, would help the ultra poor develop necessary human, social, economic and political capital to graduate out of extreme poverty within a defined time period. Usually graduation approach model is implemented for 3 years, but in some cases, in some special cases like ABTG and like other community, it might take some time, but in general, our experience says that graduation approach is implemented in 3 years. In Trickle Up also, we don't call use the word beneficiary, we call them project participants. So I'll be using this word off and on. As I mentioned, that Trickle Up has been very active in India in three states for last 15 years. So Trickle Up has been able to positively impact the lives of around 200,000 women, 2 lakhs women living in ultra poverty in India. In fact, the impact studies reveal many of the agencies has done impact evaluation, like KPMG, London School of Economics, and several other international agencies. And it's revealed that around 70% ultra poor participant reported an increase in income up to 15,000 rupees per annum. Around 88% of project participants reported in an increase in savings, and around 80% participants are now engaged in 2 or more dignified livelihood activities, thus mitigating risk. So most of our families were doing just one livelihood activities, and which was also not sustainable. So we learned that unless until we do the diversified and dignified livelihood activity, so most of our project participants have 2, 3, or 4 livelihood activities. 97% of ultra poor women are integrated into self-help groups, and they are actively engaged in savings and credit activities, and 90% of participants have access to entitlements enabling social inclusion. So the very first thing in Trickle Up we do that we make them Indian citizen. What I mean that we like identify those villages and like most of our project participant, we never experienced that they had Aadhaar card, job card or Ration card. So we start. Now coming to solution approach, it starts with identification of project participant, and we do it through PRA method. We have a very robust process of targeting where the committee members are engaged to identify the poorest household in the village. So it's not NGO worker, or it's not Trickle Up, or it's not a partner NGO or Mukhiya or Sarpanch who does. It's a through PRA and the targeting method. It's a community which says that okay, this is the most poorest household. The next important activity is institutional inclusion helps in bringing sustainability into development intervention, as well as mainstreaming of excluded house. Because it promotes participant to come into the institutional fold and access facilities of savings, credit, as well as financial literacy. As I mentioned, that we link them with different schemes, with different banks, with different panchayat schemes. So we ensure inclusion. Either new SHGs are formed or project participants are linked with the existing functional SHG, because we see that any of the SHG in the villages are like dysfunctional. Participants are also encouraged to take a small loan existing SHGs for meeting consumption related requirement. And Trickle Up focuses in developing, as I mentioned, individual livelihood plan for the participant. During the preparation of the individual livelihood plan, the household current financial status, their background, what they have been doing is taken into account, and it is prepared for participating household as per the needs, feasibility and requirement. We do market analysis also, that what is visible in that area. This helps in designing a household centering approach which was based on the strength of that household than following a generalist approach that will give pigs or chicken or seed or agriculture equipment or anything. Our coaches, each of the participants are like coach and mentored by the coaches. In some cases, we call them a smart sakhi. In some courses we call them community facilitator. So the coach assists the household in developing individual livelihood planning, and these livelihood plans are reviewed on a very regular basis on the positive as well as negative progress of the enterprise. Post that, Trickle Up supports in accumulating productive assets, help in enhancing the livelihood. Capacity building is one of the most important part. The day we select the project participant, the process of capacity building goes on. Training is provided in the area related to the selected livelihood activities, financial literacy, SHG functioning, and governance. We divided them into three part: technical part, social part, and managerial part. Technical part, all training on livestock, agriculture, and activities. Then life skills is also a very important component. Participants are also trained on relevant government schemes and program that would contribute to sustainability of their activities.
Every Sandy, just one more minute, if you could just this thing.
Relating to that, I will. In terms of digital program, I would like to introduce a program called Empowered, which is supported by the Tata Communication. This program is being implemented in Jharkhand and like Orissa. Along with the Dehishan approach for the livelihood, we have taken steps for the digital enablement for the livelihood skill building and accessing information. It is learned that a smartphone, especially when coupled with effective coaching, can help women gain access to information that can boost the productivity and profitability of their livelihood, connecting them to government social security scheme. We have also developed a package of practices in five languages, Hindi, English, Santhali, Ho, and Uriya. And this is a shared device model where one smartphone is being used by 3-4 of the participant. We have also got a digital coach called Smart Sakhi in each villages, who are the coach and mentors of this 3,000 women with whom we work. In terms of our monitoring, evaluation, and learning, these are the integral components of Trickle Up development projects. These activities together ensure that all inputs earmarked for project activity are well utilized in time to produce the desired output to achieve the chosen goals and objectives of the project. Thank you. I would like to, if you have any question, I'd like to answer at the end.
Thank you so much, Sushant. And I think we will take questions, but at the end of the session. So the participants may have listed their questions, but really informative schemes and, steps. Two, three things that particularly, was a huge learning was this concept of PRA that you do with the community, which I'm sure, has leads to very good targeting. The other thing is when you talk about giving loans for also consumption, because for this section of the population, I think we have to be careful of that some loans have to also be given for consumption. And that is what we do with our SHGs also, that their internal loans can be used for consumption, but the bank loans or the higher credit loans should go for enterprise development. And the other thing also that you spoke about, that helping women have 2-3 livelihoods, to cover the risks and also to have some increased income, not just be dependent on one livelihood option. So, and of course, Smart Sakhis. I think it's a wonderful concept to have business mentors or coach or Smart Sakhis who actually help, because all of us need guidance, especially when it comes to upscaling one's enterprises. So thank you so much, Sushant. I would now like to move to my next panelist, Dr. Maninder Kaur Dwivedi, who is the Principal Secretary, Department of Rural Industries, Government of Chhattisgarh. Dr. Maninder, you have been someone who has been very passionate about promoting Chhattisgarh art, tribal weaves, across the country and even globe, as if I may say so. And despite your very high profile postings in the Government of India and Government of Chhattisgarh, you have been doggedly somehow pursuing this upscaling of entrepreneurship opportunities among the artisans, and really helping people explore their opportunities and promoting Chhattisgarh art. And now in your current capacity as Principal Secretary of Rural Industries, I'm sure you have a lot more opportunities to do so. What we would like to know from you is on a very significant part of livelihoods promotion of marketing. Marketing the Chhattisgarh art, the tribal weaves, the work of artisans. How do you tie up with private players? How you scale up to see that the brand reaches across the country or the globe? So, and also happy to hear of any innovative strategies that you have undertaken to just promote livelihoods of the artisans. So over to you, Maninder.
Thank you, Madhuji. So when I speak, I'll be speaking primarily of people who are working with either the handicraft or the handloom sector or the artisanal goods, whatever is handmade. Marketing at a remunerative rate is actually one of the toughest things in this whole chain. Marketing at a rate which may border on exploitative is easier. So for this, I think what we have followed, I'm not saying we've kind of reached any great success, but what we followed is we've been open to all ideas, because we try 10, 5 work out, 5 just kind of fizzle out because it doesn't work out. What we get in exchange for the group or the women it's not a fair pay for the kind of effort which they've put in. So the first effort is with the group itself. The poor are not conditioned to dealing with retail orders and bulk orders. To them, you know, I sell this at this rate. So the whole concept of bulk marketing is something which we've been fairly successful. But it's not just a problem with the poor, it's also a problem with our buyers. So people are so used to saying, okay, I am going to buy 100 of these. So, you know, the rate can't be what it was for one. And it is extremely difficult to explain to the educated that this product is costed basing on the raw material plus the wages. It's not a factory product. So the margins for them to reduce prices for the bulk is very, very limited. It's there when it's an agri produce, because, you know, the holding cost is much more. But this has been an education. It has been educational for us also, working both with the groups as well as the buyers. So what has worked is that we have spoken to everybody. Sometimes these are really, really small niche orders, but then they are orders which boost up the confidence of the group. So-and-so also bought our product. So, you know, the product, the value may be very small. And then there are the bulk orders which keeps the livelihood going. You know, we would know that this group would have enough work for the next 6 months. So one underlying principle is there must be multiple buyers for each group. There are N number of so-called success stories which fizzle out because the buyer was just one government scheme or one government agency, which may have proved to be very steady and stable for 6 months, 6 years, whatever. And when that scheme is over, there are no other buyers for their products. And all of a sudden, these groups which are doing exceptionally well are nowhere. So with each group, we say, you cannot have just one market linkage. No matter how good it is, you have to have alternatives to fall back on. Second thing which we realized, marketing by itself is not so easy because different buyers require different kind of certifications. So for food, it may be FSSAI. For silk, it may be a silk mark. There are N number of certifications in each segment. Handholding the groups through this is not really a part of marketing, but it's an essential of marketing. It takes time. It takes an effort. Trying to get those certifications out of government agencies is another effort. Marketing also involves a lot of product redevelopment and product positioning. I would say this when we started working with the handloom weavers and they were selling their silk. So it was the competing market is art silk, which is basically polyester pretending to be silk, or it is based on imported yarns. So this whole positioning that we are sustainable, we are local, we don't leave a carbon footprint, this positioning is extremely important. It takes time. E-market, I know everybody says e-platforms, but e-platforms are themselves, it is an effort and one has to assess whether it's an effort worth putting their group through, because e-platforms have a lot of hidden costs. There's the cost of photography, the cost of holding the inventory, and then at some stage they start telling you, you have to give sponsored, whatever they call it, promotions, otherwise your product won't show on our big, huge omnibus e-platform. Then they kind of twist you into hiring warehouse space. So these hidden costs, not every group would be able to sustain. The other kind of e-platforms are where they're willing to take products on consignment. We'll take this on consignment and we will sell it and we'll pay back the group, which sounds very good. But a consignment which is given for 45 days or 90 days or credit terms beyond a month actually make it a loss-making exercise for the group. So to deal with all this, one has to find partnerships. We've been very fortunate in a few partners which have really helped the groups, connected them to other buyers. But at the same time, a lot of big brands just let you down somewhere along the path. But the basic principle which we've dealt with for the tie-ups is that the women or the group should get a fair price and a fair wage. So wherever this has been an issue of negotiation, it's been easier for everybody to walk off. I mean, this is a non-negotiable where you're dealing with artisans. Again, what I mentioned earlier, the consignments and credit terms do not work for the poor. They are not meant to favor the group. These are big conglomerates, you know, to whom it really doesn't make a dent to them if they spend 10,000 on an outright purchase. But for this group, it could be pushing them back into whatever level they've gone up. And again, even with tie-ups, I think monopoly needs to be avoided. When you mentioned scaling, I'm not sure there's any answer to scaling. It has to be as to what is your supply of local material and what is the capacity of the group. Sometimes it's organic once you start getting bigger orders, like we started getting for our tribal paintings. The Godna art is what it is called. Then the women just co-opted their daughters or their daughters-in-law and they said, we'll outsource the household labor because this was a more this was better for the family as a whole. So the scaling is organic. It's not something which I think it's better to keep it that way rather than, you know, plan for it and then build up hopes. So size per se doesn't matter of the whole exercise, so long as the group is getting a fair price and a fair return for them. You also mentioned innovations. I'm not really saying we're doing things which are very innovative. It's probably just rediscovering the wheels. So we have basically followed the input chain and the supply chains to make maximum use of local material and local livelihoods. I'll give you an instance. Like we have an apparel sector in our with our handloom weaver societies. So we gradually replaced all their plastic buttons and plastic zippers with handmade bamboo buttons. So we had these cushion covers, which were like 200 rupees a piece, but they are clearly giving four sets of local livelihoods to the weavers, to the women's group which stitches them, to the women's group which does the embroidery or the printing, and to the groups which are making the bamboo buttons for them. So all within 200, they're all happy with the end product also. Plus, we kind of thought it's better to just phase out the plastic. And there are alternatives available. It's just that we need to look at them and we need to work at them. The same has been with our local silk. Across the country, silk yarn is, due to various reasons, more imported than local. So when we started working on the local silk, we started working on local dyes. How do you extract it fresh from the materials which are cheaply available? I mean, one can loosely call them innovations, but I think it's just building more and more livelihood in the same community on what they are doing. I think that's it for this one.
No, I think it's really fascinating. In fact, I was noting down, you know, for ourselves also, for the work that we do. So two, three things really good to, you know, adopt. One is what you talk about, that no innovations as such, just rediscovering the wheel, but trying to make sure that the livelihoods are generated and it is generated at fair price and it is not exploitative, and one should just keep at that instead of, you know, trying to go on scale, because it's important to give sustainable livelihoods at fair price. Rather than another thing that you mentioned also about, the hidden costs of e-commerce platforms, that also we are aware of. And that is also only for a certain section which can take that risk because of the income. But a lot of the people that we work with cannot afford to take that risk of covering the hidden costs. And also, I was amused that somebody from the government talks about the problems or the time it takes in certification, because we do the same. So that was, a kind of a moment for me, because we are, because, you know, in Punjab, we try to produce, a lot of food processing, food products. And the kind of, the hassle that we had to go through for certification, we realize. So I'm glad that somebody from the government also faces similar issues that we, private players do. So, but really fascinating the work that you are doing, and you have done amazing work in actually reviving artisans and handicrafts and handlooms. So good luck to you. We'll come back to you. And now moving on to our, thank you, Maninder. Moving on to our third speaker for the day, Mr. Binju Ibrahim. Binju is the integrator of Pradhan, and all of us who work in the development sector have obviously heard a lot about Pradhan's work. Pradhan's work in actually working on a very, very community-driven participatory approach. Pradhan is an organization that has really led the way in actually working for the poorest of the poor in Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and impacted sustainable livelihoods at the grassroots. Pradhan also has done a lot of work on social security, ensuring social security, so and strengthening grassroots level institutions. And you know, for me also, while doing my PhD, which was much later than I, you know, I did so much of reading on Pradhan's work and very impressed. So Binju, if you could throw some light on the work that Pradhan has done in promoting access to social security and also on strengthening grassroots level institution. So the processes, if you could run us through. So thank you. Over to you, Binju.
Am I audible, Madhu?
Yes, you are.
And is my PPT visible?
Yes, it is.
Thank you. Thank you, Madhu. And thank you, Niti Aayog and Access team, for organizing this wonderful, conference. And I'm amazed at the, the digital conference space that you have created. Initially, I got lost, and some of my colleagues also started texting me, "Kaise jana hai?" But I think, like it happens in a big summit, we do get lost. But then, yeah, I was quite inspired and impressed by this setup. Thanks. And what also motivates me to join this webinar is the topic on ultra poor. And I'm glad that Niti Aayog is also participating in this. It is a big challenge for all of us who are in the poverty sector. The growth that India saw in the last few decades has been now deeply compromised by the COVID crisis, also the way we managed COVID. So I am very grateful that people are bothered about ultra poor, have come together and made this session together. So thank you for that. Briefly about Pradhan, as you already mentioned, Madhu, that Pradhan has been in the field of poverty alleviation since 1983. And we began with this idea that, you know, people with head and heart, capable and caring people, if they are placed at the grassroots, right at the panchayat and block level, can transform people's lives. So we are now around 1,000 odd people who are placed in 61 block locations of extreme poverty hotbeds of Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Odisha, West Bengal, these Central Eastern India. And we mainly work on organizing communities into collectives. We have some 60,000 odd SHGs now. We have over 1,000 federations, block level federations, and around 80 odd cooperatives of farmers on goat, on tusser, on various others. So the one thing that we do is organizing communities into groups. And then the other thing that we do is we know that we are working with resource-rich poor, as we say. So we do a lot of natural resource management work, bunding, leveling, plantation, irrigation, forestry, and such kind of work. And third thing that we do is building livelihood systems on existing livelihoods, largely livestock, agriculture, rain-fed crops, and all kind of livelihood systems that people depend on, both food and cash. And then we work on life, well-being of people, gender, governance, drinking water, nutrition, now also in public health as well. And finally, we do a lot of public not exactly an advocacy, but more public influencing social policies of the state through some of our demonstrations. Now, quickly coming to this thing, while Pradhan has made significant progress in terms of helping some 10 lakh odd households directly, and of course we work indirectly with large number of partners and governments, we have made significant poverty in helping these families come out of poverty through various prototypes. Some 30-35 prototypes are already a part of government programs on tusser, on lac, on poultry, and natural resource management and all. But there is also angst in Pradhan that we realize that we had an appalling failure in lifting those households who are experiencing extreme multiple deprivations, the ultra poor, who are left out from not just Pradhan's programs, but also from the signals that modern democracy, modern state, and markets offer. So that is where we really got concerned, and in Pradhan now we have a internal resource group which looks at specifically ultra poor. So anyway, Pradhan is working in the poverty poorer geographies, but then we made an effort to understand the segment of ultra poor, and I'll come to that quickly. So there are many ways to that Pradhan is attempting. I would still say attempting, because these are all innovations at this point. Just three and a half, four years that we realized and started this journey with the ultra poor. So today I'm only going to talk about our work with CBOs, as Madhu requested, who are in the frontiers of helping ultra poor connect to the social security programs. What you see in the screen is Jimia Kerai from Chaibasa district. She's 81 years old. She didn't have a bank account or an Aadhaar card. She lost her husband long back, and her children actually migrated to some place that she didn't know. And the SSG through help desk actually helped her to access pension and ration. At 81, she didn't have a ration card. She didn't have a pension. These two things have really helped her to live a dignified life, not necessarily a livelihood program that she would engage into. And I appreciate Sushant's model of graduation approach, which we are still learning on that curve. So that is what I'll quickly now get into a few slides to just briefly tell who are we talking about. That is very important to know who we are talking about, and I'll not dwell much on this slide. Two things that I wanted to tell. When we talk about ultra poor, one thing is, you know, the area where Pradhan works is already extremely poor, and not, I mean, the World Bank puts it at $2 a day, which comes to be around 2.5 lakh rupees per annum for these families. But it is interesting to note that the areas where Pradhan works, this Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand tribal heartland, the average annual income, household income, is just 72,000, and we don't have any families at 2 lakh, 2.5 lakh, the World Bank standards of poverty line. So almost all, I mean 98% of households that we work are actually poor. But then within that category, there are people whom we are calling as ultra poor, and I define them as a category of people who are living below 35,000 income per year. So within that category, what we realize is that there are two categories. And Sushant actually in his sharing did mention in some subtle way, and they both need different treatment. So the people who are above 35,000 income per year are able to catch to, and we call that category. So we are divided into A, B, C, D, E. This is typically what Pradhan does and any organization does as wealth ranking in the village to target. And we realize that A and B categories are the people who are left out, and A and B are different. And A are people whom I just mentioned about, like Jimia Kerai, who are experiencing extreme hunger or ill, who don't have anybody who can help them. They're destitute, they're single, old aged, very little assets in their homes, only utensils you would see. And sometimes they're also ostracized by the community because of various social norms. The other category are people who are unable to catch up with the Pradhan's program or government program because of one or more factors of livelihoods that doesn't suit them. Say, for example, they are landless, or they don't have a bullock, or they have indebted jameen wagara wo bandhak mein rakh diye hai, or repeatedly falling ill, or do not have adult who are of working age, bacche hai ya bahut boodhe hain, is tarah ka, or they remain underemployed or looking for casual labor. So these are the two category of people whom we would like to, when we say who are ultra poor, jiske bare mein hum baat kar rahe hain. The second thing that I want to bring through the slide is that we need to focus both the reasons of poverty as well as the effects of poverty. So Sushant mentioned about vulnerables and ultra poor, but then if we need to focus both on targeting vulnerables as well as the vulnerabilities, the reasons for they become, because they keep on moving in that slide. So I wanted to bring this notice that there are vulnerabilities that we need to work on, both on the economic front and social norms that amplify these vulnerabilities. Of course, there are geographical, COVID jaisa cheez ya famine jaisa cheez aate hain, there are also geographical reasons of vulnerabilities. I move on, I know my time is less. I go to the next slide. So what are the ways that Pradhan thought that we can help communities come out of poverty? I'll be talking about largely today about the 10 pathways that Pradhan has thought. First is very clearly, as I told about Jimia's case, if we can help them access to social protection programs, the government of India announces a lot of protection programs. Either people don't know about it, or the bureaucratic administration is weak, or there are local nexus of, you know, the takedar and middlemen, which actually takes away the benefits. So for many reasons, or the Panchayati Raj institutions or the local administration itself is very weak. So one of the things that we work on is, you know, improving social protection, access to social protection programs, MNREGA, pensions, ration, Matritva Vandana kind of program. So I'll talk to, that will be the point one is what I want to deal with the next slide. Second is, you know, we wanted to look at how can Pradhan's program or government's programs can be, you know, prototyped in a manner where which ultra poor can participate. So backyard poultry, you know, small ruminants rearing, nutri gardens, mushroom, those kind of, we say, low risk, low gain activities, because they want more assurance rather than big gains. Third is access to assets. So a large number of people in these regions do not have access to forest or commons or water. So this is very important. Second, by allocation. I think Sushan mentioned about in his presentation about how they give, you know, one-time grant. So it could be a cycle, a goat, a pump set, which actually can transform, you know, help them kickstart their enterprises. Or by construction. Under NREGA, we have helped communities, you know, grow plantations, wells, ponds, which actually helps them to restart their livelihoods. Fourth is what we say, Sushant also just mentioned, that, you know, ensuring that they participate, they're able to participate in the SHG, because many of them are left out of SHGs. And we've also tried to help women become, from the ultra poor categories, become mukhyas, because they are part of federations. And when they become mukhyas, when the women, ultra poor women, becomes mukhyas of a federation.
Sorry, Binju, you have just 2-3 minutes more. So yeah.
Okay, I'll move to the next slide. I'll share the slides later. See, the slide that I wanted to share is about this powerful idea, innovation that Pradhan colleagues have done in roughly around 80 gram panchayats over the last 3-4 years. This is the model. So I was telling how CBOs can help improve access to social security programs for the ultra poor. So what happens is, as you've seen, I just made it up today, yesterday, so it is not a very neat graphic as, you know, Access Livelihood would want. Their graphics are so beautiful. We have identified some, in every village there is a Samvidhan Sathi. Samvidhan Sathi Didi kya karti hai? She's trained in a civic literacy program. She trains communities, SHGs and VOs on a civic literacy module. It's a political education module about modern democracy, about schemes, about rights, entitlements, and what are the documents that you need to keep ready to, and which department do you go and apply on all those things. Ek Samvidhan Sathi bolke cadre ko humne, just like a CR, community resource person livelihoods, this is a community resource person on rights and entitlement. So she helps in raising awareness and helping them in enrolling in various programs. So she is the one who actually brings. So then there is every panchayat has a help desk. So this help desk is basically 2 to 3 women actually having a table with a computer and some, you know, registers, where they actually help these ultra poor households. They just don't work for ultra poor, but then all sabhi citizens ko help karte hai, but this is specifically for ultra poor. So this help desk, actually they have awareness program, they have enrollment registers, then they have a grievance work that they do, and they do it around different kinds of programs, including accessing helping them in doing GPDP planning and FRA, making claims under FRA, forest CFR, IFR banane ke liye. And the panchayat mukhya, then they also help panchayat mukhya document their enrollment needs and grievance needs, and then send it to respective department in the mukhya's letterhead. And the issues that we are unable to solve, we also have what we call as Nagrik Sahayata Kendras in 24 blocks. And it is very interesting that as we talk today, the government of Jharkhand is launching 60 new blocks with support from Welthangal Life in 60 new blocks of Jharkhand, this Nagrik Sahayata Kendras. This is again, this is now picking up pace. So, and then this the issues that the you know, there is something called a Gram Panchayat Coordination Committee, where the PRI members, so this is a new, government of India has, the government of Jharkhand has issued a new guideline from the Panchayat Raj Department that apart from the Gram Panchayat Executive Committee meeting, there will be a Gram Panchayat Coordination Committee meeting where the citizens and the CBO leaders would also participate. So the issues that are not you know, adequately handled at the GP help desk level, it goes to GPCC. And again, when GPCC is not able to handle, it goes to the Narega Nagrik Sahayata Kendra, which is based at the block headquarter. And that is also having an MOU with the social audit unit of the rural development department. So this is one big thing that I want to talk about. And I quickly want to share with you the results of the 22 blocks that we are working on with this idea. We have been able to help with Narega in the last 6 months. I have a little outdated data, recent data nahi mil paya. So these are some of the figures as you see, GP help desk ke maande se madad hua. This is a study that was done by, very recent study that was done by XIMB, Xavier Institute for Management Bhubaneswar, which actually tells the impact, a comparative analysis. As you see, you know, pension ration job card ko analyze kiye hain. Intervened GP, non-intervened GP, you see that comparative analysis, 4 times higher pensions bane hain, 6 times higher ration bane hain, job cards 10 times jyada bane hain. And if you see in monetary terms, it is 8 times higher when you have a Gram Panchayat help desk. These are some of the citizens' advantage. Basically, the XIMB study showed that average Gram Panchayat help desk mein jab didi jaati hai, to unko 57 rupees kharcha hota hai. But agar वहां नॉर्मली वो किसी को बिचौलियों के माध्यम से जाते हैं तो 200 रुपया लगता है, तकरीबन उनको एक साल जैसा लग जाता है. जो ग्राम पंचायत हेल्प डेस्क में हमको 2 से 3 महीने में ही इनका प्रोसेसिंग हो गया. दिस आर सम ऑफ द पिक्चर्स. मधु, आई नो आई एम लेट, आई एम सॉरी, आई एम क्लोजिंग इट. दिस आर सम ऑफ द पिक्चर्स ऑफ द जीपी हेल्प डेस्क. दिस इज एन एडवोकेसी दैट द वीमेन डिड बिकॉज ऑफ अ मैल प्रैक्टिस दैट दे शो. दिस इज अ पिक्चर फ्रॉम बोकारो. आई स्टॉप हियर. थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर द टाइम दैट यू गेव मी.
No, but thank you so much, Binju. You know, you took us to another world. You actually transported us to a world of so much change at the grassroots. And you see this picture, these pictures speak a lot. And thank you for taking us through the process of, you know, such well-defined systems to impact change. And the results of your GPHD, you know, how well it has been defined, and how from one level to another there is a grievance redressal, there is a system to impact change. So, and that is why I think Pradhan, the results of the impact of Pradhan is what it is. So much of participatory approach, working with the government, working with the communities. So thank you for that. I don't think our fourth panelist has joined. I think he was on his way. He was at the airport. Mr. Bal Murugan, the Secretary of Rural Development of Government of Bihar, and also the CEO of BRLPS. Mayank, has Mr. Bal Murugan joined?
No, Dr. Sharan, he hasn't joined.
Mayuk, yeah. He hasn't
joined. We believe he will not be joining today.
Okay, he will not be joining. So fine. So then I should not have hurried the participants, the panelists so much. I just feel bad. So maybe I'll give them a little more time to do the next round of questions. So just the final concluding remarks from all the three panelists. So we would just like to know from you, starting from Sushant, then Binju, and then finally Maninder. Maninder's question will be different because she's with the government. So maybe I think I will have to rephrase it. But Binju and Sushant, any top three policy changes or strategic changes that you would like for the government to think about to impact, to promote livelihoods for the poor? So any three policy changes or strategic changes that you would like to see from the government for an enabling environment to impact livelihoods for the poor? So whoever would like to go first.
Yeah, I can start.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, as far as this policy recommendation to government is concerned, I think we all have to understand that poor is not a monolithic or homogeneous group and has many different layers within the ultra poor or very poor or poor group. In fact, the ultra poor require a special support and focus, and policy should take care that into account, because they need a special support, they need a special care. And policy mainstreaming of issue concerning people living with ultra poor, that's one thing that we have to understand, that there is not a poor, very poor, or like ultra poor. There are like different layers within, and like every layers need a special focus and a special support. Yes. Secondly, I'll say that moving away from the universal schemes for the poor, state and national government should promote executing ultra poor schemes. In fact, I'm very glad to say that few states have already started a sort of ultra poor and PVTG division. I'm very glad to say that few of the states have started, but still a long way to go. And a special and exclusively vocational skill building program for ultra poor with end to end support to make them self employed and like take them and again graduate them out of poverty. The third, which is, and the third one, that this policy need to consider risk very much related to climate change and disaster, because we know that states like Andhra, Orissa, Bengal, after every 3 months you think, oh, cyclone is coming, flood is coming. So policy need to consider risk related to climate change and disaster, which pose overwhelming threats to the lives and livelihood both of the ultra poor family.
Yes, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Ishan. I would love, you know, Binju, I think just very quickly in 1 minute, the three policy changes that you would like to see.
Yeah. First is, you know, as Sushant said, you know, the ultra poor requires grants. Unfortunately, in the NRLM system and all other in Pradhan system also, we want everybody to take loans. Loans add risk to these families. They are not risk averse, because they already have so many precarious situations in their life. They really need startup grants. So Sushant has mentioned ultra poor requires special startup grants, and every government has to mandate it. And I would request that in the GPDP planning, which then currently it is going on in the whole country, we should have a special component. Kerala has something called an Asraya component for the Gram Panchayat that they, during their planning. So this is one thing. Second is, you know, our women collectives have shown excellently that they managed microfinance activity very well. My second suggestion is that the state legitimizes CBOs as women, just like they did wonderful work in microfinance and livelihoods. They can actually help in a social security program, improving access to social security programs. They can break the middleman system that is operating. So that is the second thing, you know, bring government orders which legitimizes CBO's role in social security programs. Third is, every panchayat should have a Gram Panchayat help desk. Kerala has a front office which they actually source from their own source revenues. So unfortunately, in the states that we work, there is, panchayats do not have the power. Many, some of the states have, some do not have. Jharkhand doesn't have. They don't have a power to generate their own resources. If they had, they could have easily run a GP help desk. So establish help desk in all Gram Panchayat secretariats and allow Gram Panchayats to generate their own sources. And finally, in Jharkhand, there is a huge मिस इंफॉर्मेशन ऑन द आधार. आई मीन जब आधार बन रहा था, जैसे मैंने जो महिला को दिखाया, इस तरह की बहुत महिलाएं जिनका एज 60 के नीचे है, एंड इट इज नॉट रेयर. एवरी विलेज हैज अ 20% लेवल तक का एरर है. आधार करेक्शन बिकॉज इट समटाइम्स सीम्स टू बी सम काइंड ऑफ अ कॉन्स्पिरेंसी अगेंस्ट दिस एल्डरली पीपल. सो ये आधार में करेक्शन होना जरूरी है. आई स्टॉप हियर.
Okay, thank you so much, Binju. Maninder, I would also like you to ask you two things. There is a question from Badri Narayan Sahu from International Center for Research and in Agroforestry. Will poverty ever be terminated from the society? So you have to. So I don't know whether poverty will ever be terminated, but I think from the government you can give us some perspective on that. And also something from the government, maybe top two changes that you are thinking to implement, to impact livelihoods.
I wish I could answer, would poverty ever be eliminated? I think the definition of poverty will keep changing. As societies evolve, grow, the value systems change, but there will always be some inequality, though I really hope it isn't so that some people are really deprived just from the basics. So this is, I wish I had a crystal ball and I could answer it. I really can't. The second changes, it's not so much as changes, it's more of a wish list, which I can say.
Yes,
it's three. So one would be, I think there should be a system in place where our products carry a fair wage or a fair practice kind of certification. I don't know who can do it, whether it's the government or the civil society, but somebody needs to do it. Everybody wants to position themselves and saying, I'm wearing this, or I'm using this, or I'm consuming this. But nobody wants to know whether there was a fair wage which went for it. And that is what will actually change everything. I'm glad Shushanji mentioned climate change. We have conferences of climate change. We discuss it. We write about it. But in the products which we use every day, all of us, are we contributing to those? I mean, we are all contributing to it one way or the other. So this I'm saying specifically because I think we need money in all schemes to go in for local small research projects. What is available locally? This, I'm very briefly telling you, this stems from an old document which we found about handlooms of this area, where we discovered that the tribals used to weave hair lotus stem residue into their patas. So the higher you up in the social hierarchy, the more lotus stem would be there in your fabric. And the lesser, the proportion of cotton will keep increasing. We couldn't find anybody who could tell us where they sourced or how they did it, but when we look for it internationally, there are countries in Southeast Asia which are selling lotus fabric at extremely high rates. Those societies are really earning well. So as of now, you look at the agriculture universities across schemes, but funds, we need funds for small local research to best use what is left as agricultural waste or wastes of other byproducts. This is, I think, very critical because we're spending money into flooding the country, whether it is with yarn, which is made from petroleum origin products, or it is packaging or everything. We had this knowledge, we've lost it, we need to rediscover it. And my last point would be for all skilling projects, for everything, rather than telling the people, isko aise seekho, whether it's on a biometric or a CCTV or whatever, speak to the people. They will give you more solutions than any bureaucrat ever would. And I can just say this, we were talking to them, what are the mats you use at home? And we had a complete new range of handicrafts, which was sheened and kansa grass and everything from baskets to table mats to everything made out of that. And the people laughed at us. Somebody buy this, we don't sell it. And those sell very well. So it's like, it should be bottom up. I know it's like 30 years of, I've been hearing of it for 26 years, bottom up. But that's what needs to come about. Yes. Very confidently. Thank you.
So thank you so much. I think we are just on time to end this session. So thank you very much, the panelists. So just summarizing 1 minute, I think we all talk about the same. I think Sushant is doing trickle up, and Maninder, you talk of bottom up, and Binju talks about participatory approach. I think we just do the same. Good livelihoods planning, graduation approach, participatory approach, working with the community, what Maninder says, these women know everything, their math, their work, they know everything. Of course, livelihood financing is important, Mentorship is important for what I realize, whether hand in hand, we work with business development service providers, what we call smart sakhis is what is known as trickle up, or samvidhan sahelis, I think some that term that you use. But the idea is to have some kind of mentors or community resource persons to help in sustainability, and finally to address issues of climate change also in working for livelihoods for the poor. So with that, thank you so much for a really, really enriching and illuminating session. Thank you so much, everyone.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, everybody, for the time.
Thank you, Dr. Sharon. And thank you to all the panelists for this very enriching discussion today. It was grounded in real examples from the rural India. And special thanks to Dr. Madhusharan for so effectively spearheading this conversation and steering it to a very succinct summary at the end. You brought to the fore some of the major issues, like you talked about how there's no need to rediscover the wheel, but make it more effective, either through novel approaches, new technologies, or through looking at it through new lenses that are required, such as sustainability. And thank you for bringing on the very profound statement that we just don't need to look at the effects of poverty, but the reasons of poverty, or in other words, not just the vulnerable, but the vulnerabilities. So with that, I will close the session. But before closing the session, I would also like to once again thank all the delegates who logged in for the session and participated through your questions. We will be back in this hall at 1:45 p.m. for our track 4 discussions on building a sustainable ecosystem for farmer producer organizations. But before that, in the meanwhile, I would request and encourage the audience to please move to Hall 1, where we have a very eagerly awaited fireside chat coming up with S. Shivakumar, Group Head, Agri and IT Business, ITC Limited. This fireside chat is titled On the Spot with Shiv, Scaling Up Farmer Producer Companies, Lessons from Cooperatives. And in this session, we have Dr. R.S. Sodhi, Managing Director, Amul, in conversation with S. Shivakumar. So thank you, audience, and thank you, panelists, once again for joining us today. We end the session.
Thank you.